اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، نحمده ونستعين به ونتوكل عليه، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف خلقه، خاتم أنبيائه، وسيد رسله، نبينا وحبيب قلوبنا وشفيع ذنوبنا، أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المطهرين المكرمين. Respected elders, sisters and brothers, salamun alaykum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. One of the things that most of us indeed miss during this challenging time of COVID-19 is the attendance in majalis, is the taking part in programs in our centers, in our mosques, in our community places, in which we are able to meet others, in which we are able to somehow gather and congregate and be able to feel the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and that of the honoring of the Ahlul Bayt, peace and blessings be upon them, collectively. No doubt, this isolation and lockdown throughout the world in many, many places has resulted in the feeling that some people may have towards majalis, in that they will yearn and look forward towards attending them and taking part in them even more than perhaps before. Now, the idea that emerges when you think about the whole concept of the establishment of a majlis, despite alhamdulillah the ability to be able to hold these majalis online now, and this shows the wonderful, extensive eagerness of the mu'mineen and mu'minat to keep the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alive, to keep remembering their marhumeen, to keep, of course, upholding the flags of Ali Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon them, something which no doubt makes the Holy 12th Imam, ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif, very happy. Now, somebody asked the question, the whole notion of establishing a majlis or holding a majlis, is it something that is found in the Holy Quran or not? The idea that people come forward and say, you hold these majalis out there. Is the word majlis even mentioned in the Quran? Because in the Arabic language, the idea that emerges regarding the word majlis is a gathering, somewhere where people congregate, come together. But in its usage today, it is somehow denoting a gathering whereby there is a speech, whereby there is a form of a commemoration, there is a purpose behind this gathering, which of course is holy, which is sacred, which is highly rewarding and beneficial, no doubt. Somebody asks the question, is it something that we can find in the Holy Quran or not? Yes. It is actually mentioned in chapter 58 of the Holy Quran, Surah Al-Mujadala. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions what is necessary in the Holy Quran. And of course, the Holy Ahlul Bayt, the Holy Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt come forward and describe what is necessary. And they are the ones who explain the Holy Quran to us. But the word majlis is found in Surah Al-Mujadala. Now, in which capacity, in which way is majlis mentioned in the Holy Quran? It is within the whole discussion surrounding etiquette, surrounding what is known as adab. Many a times we are reminded by scholars, by thinkers, by learned individuals of the role that etiquettes and adab have in the religion of Islam. Because if you look at many other faiths and systems out there, you have what is known as law, you have what is known as obligation and prohibition. The religion of Islam as a holistic religion comes forward and says prohibition and obligation do exist. Al-wujub wa nahi are certainly integral part of our teachings. Islamic law is there for all of us to kind of apply into our lives. But at the same time, there are certain dimensions which are key for our personal development, which are key for our spirituality. These are known as etiquettes, adab, manners. And truly, the religion of Islam is full of these, based on the system of akhlaq and a high ethical conduct that the Holy Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam brought forward for mankind. People say adab is the kind of expression of the highest levels of akhlaq, you know, sometimes known as makarimul akhlaq, because it is not easy to always uphold these adab. It's a matter of continuous struggle, refining, self-scrutinization. But it is something that can become second nature. It is something that you and I can develop in our lives. And it is the habit of the Prophet and the Imam alayhum as-salam. You know, the narration of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, this is found in Bihar and other sources. The Holy Prophet, peace be upon him and his family, says, "Ana adibullah wa aliyun adibi." I am the one who has been trained by Allah with adab, and I taught these adab to Ali ibn Abi Talib. Subhanallah. And then Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, another narration comes forward and says, "Inna Rasulullah addabahu Allah." The Holy Messenger was trained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but primarily on akhlaq and adab. وَهُوَ أَدَّبَنِي And he's the one who has brought me up and taught me the etiquettes and mannerism. وَأَنَا أُؤَدِّبُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ And I am the teacher, I am the master, I am the one who instills these adab in the believers. This is truly significant and very, very important when it comes to our lives and when it comes to seeking benefit from the lives of the Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Now, if you look at the books of Adab, they'll tell you things to do, for example, before eating, things to do before walking, things, for example, that you and I are recommended to uphold before going to sleep, like, for example. We are told, for example, the focusing on the Qibla when it comes to our sleep. Like, for example, our feet should be towards the Qibla if we can, if our bed is in the direction. Notice that in the sleep state, it is recommended to be in that position, whereby if you stand up, if you sit from the sleeping position, you're facing the Qibla. But in the place where we go, where we relieve ourselves, like the bathroom or the restroom or the toilet, it is forbidden for us to be facing the Qibla. Neither are we allowed to have our backs completely to the Qibla. It is haram where this actual act take place for us to be facing or to have the Qibla at our back. Notice in the sleep, it is also recommended, for example, to have the state of wudu, to do ta'awud min ash-shaytan, to say a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim, recite surah al-takathur, surah al-ikhlas, surah al-qadr, surah al-kafirun, to be sleeping with an empty bladder, to be sleeping on our sides, on our backs, not our stomachs, to read tasbihah of Fatima to Zahra, salawatullahi wa salamu alayha. These are adab for you and I to make our sleep more spiritual, to gain more thawab out of the system of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He had presented you and I. Now, unfortunately, in this day and age, perhaps the elders can agree with me, but some of our youngsters and our youth may be reluctant to learn about adab, to learn about etiquettes. They say, you know what, we'll just stick to the basics. We'll stick to what is haram and what is halal. Don't tell me about what I ought to be doing. Tell me if it's halal or not. Tell me if it's haram or not. Unfortunately, they have missed the point of how certain things lead to certain things. If we want barakah in our lives, if we want to be somehow in a state encapsulated and engulfed in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let's invest in our akhirah by doing some of these things which become part and parcel of our lives. Now, one important adab in the Holy Quran is in reference to gatherings, in reference to people when they gather together, and especially gatherings in which they are there to learn. They are there to understand. And perhaps, and I haven't seen this discussed by anybody, but this is maybe a concept we need to be thinking about. If we're not able to hold these majalis in person, physically, then maybe these adab also apply when we're listening to a majlis online, for example, live. Now, if it's recorded or YouTube, is something else. But if we are taking part in a majlis online live, and somebody is speaking to us, we are remembering the Ahlul Bayt, the Masaib of the Ahlul Bayt, these adab should also exist, what the Quran has actually told us. In chapter 4, verse 86, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that in gatherings of people, when you see people, make sure that you greet them, you say salam to them, and respond more than just saying wa alaykum salam. Say wa alaykum salam wa rahmatullahi wa ta'ala wa barakatuh. In chapter 33, verse 53, for example, there is adab of invitation of gathering which involves food. Don't stay too long, the Quran says. Don't be too much of a burden on the household. And so on. Let's look at chapter 58 very briefly, the story of the adab of majalis, what should be observed in a majlis that you and I are gathering, as instructed in the Holy Quran. We are told the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam was sitting in a place known as Safa, and you know, in Medina, next to his blessed mosque, and you know, the poor would congregate there. You know, it was a very packed gathering. And some of the Muslims who had fought in Badr, they were there. They said salam to the Prophet. He responded. Then they greeted the people. They responded. And they stood still because there was no place for them to sit. And the Prophet of Islam was perhaps speaking, was giving, delivering a sermon. And they just stood there. There was no space for them to sit. So Rasulullah was unhappy about this. He looked at a few and said to them, why don't you stand up to make space? Why don't you just kind of maybe sit in a position or just space yourself out so that there is more space for these brothers that have just come. Some of the people sitting there dislike this. Some of the munafiqeen seize the chance and say, look at this man. Is he just? Why do you have to make people stand up to make space for others? They came late. It's their fault. Have you been in similar situations, you know, where there's been an opportunity for, you know, in a packed gathering and there's others who'd come and be thinking, why should I make space for them? It's their fault, for example. SubhanAllah, history repeats itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals this holy verse in Surah Al-Mujadala. Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, idha qila lakum tafassahu fil majalisi fafsahu yafsahillahu lakum. Oh, you who believe, when it is said to you, move, make space in the majlis. So the word majalis is mentioned only once in the Holy Quran in this chapter. If it is said to you, make space in the majlis, then make space. Why? Why should I make space? فَفْسَحُوا يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Allah will then make space for you. Widen things for you. Now, here it's very interesting. And Mufassirin have come forward from the narrations of the Ahl al-Bayt. And I've suggested what this actually means. They all say this is a great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one says, you know, on this earth, Allah will give us more sustenance. Make space means widens your rizq for you. Yes, gives you more. Others say, no, why are we limiting it to only dunya? In akhirah, Allah will give you more, and that is in Jannah. It's not a surprise thing, because a small deed in this world may mean something tremendous in akhirah. You think that making space for someone in a majlis is small in the eyes of Allah? It is not small, because He mentions it in the Quran. يَفْسَحِ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Allah will open up things for you, will give you Jannah, will intensify and increase your rizq. Do not belittle a deed you do for the sake of Allah. Do not take for granted tawfiq from Allah to serve, to be Zair al-Husayn, Khadim al-Husayn, Khadim of the Ahl al-Bayt. This is all great reward from the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala and special tawfiq. Then the verse goes on and says, وَإِذَا قِيلَ لَكُمْ انْشُزُوا فَانْشُزُوا. When it is said to you, stand up, then stand up, make space. Why? Because there was a lot of people who were determined not to stand up and used to be a huge burden on the Holy Prophet and others. Now, the next part, according to ulama, identifies the major concept of majalis in Islam. Please mark these words of the Holy Quran. يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ. Allah will raise amongst you those who have knowledge and iman, high, lofty positions. So, iman, faith and knowledge are brought together here and linked to a majlis. there is no doubt that the purpose of majalis should be to seek ilm. Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen, peace and blessings be upon him, says, Al-ilmu aslu kullu khayr. Ilm is the root of every goodness. Yes? Al-ilmu hayat. He says, ilm is life. What more can we say than the first word revealed to the Holy Messenger, peace and blessings be upon him and his holy progeny, is iqra. Yes? So, when I come to a majlis, how do I rate a majlis or a speech? It should be on how much I have learned, not how much I have enjoyed. Please mark these words. Because I have seen and I've discussed with some of the mu'mineen, they've told me, you know, the majlis of this Mawlana, mashallah, there's some really good content. But, you know, there was nothing that made me feel good. Subhanallah. Who said it should make you feel good? Others have a counter, you know, they have this counter. Do you know what they count? They count how many times there is a Nare Haydari or Wahwa, subhanAllah. Your majlis only had 3 Nares, therefore it is not as good as the other majlis of this Zakir, Zat al-Alim, who had 50 Nares. Go and work on your majlis. Sorry, brother, the Quran doesn't talk like this. The Quran speaks about benefit as far as ilm and iman. If the majlis does not get you closer to Allah, if the majlis does not make you more stronger in iman and ilm, then it's a majlis that is useless. If it's a majlis that's feeding your ego, if it's a majlis that is only giving you what you already know, but you feel so good leaving it, and you cannot even recall what you learned after it, then you have wasted your time. But some people might be upset. But what about, you know, us? Yes, it is beneficial in the sense that, yes, gathering, and maybe there is some thawab in the remembrance of Ahlul Bayt. But the Quran tells us that the true remembrance of Ali Muhammad is that ilm that makes you closer to Ali Muhammad. Is that what? That iman that makes you of the muwaleen of Ali Muhammad. Yes? And so the recognition that emerges is the following, that the Quran identifies these etiquettes that should be observed. And that means when I attend a majlis, whether online or actual, I need to increase knowledge every time. Maybe I should make notes. Maybe I should ask questions. Maybe I should reflect. Maybe I should discuss with my friends and colleagues and family, whatever I can, in order to ensure that I am fulfilling this criteria. And that is why Imam Zain al-Abidin al-Sajjad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, the courtyard of La'in, Yazid ibn Muawiyah, when Yazid, you know, would want to humiliate him, Imam Zain al-Abidin said, allow me to speak to the people. Let me give a majlis. Why? Because I want to say things that is pleasing to Allah and beneficial to the people. Two things. I am going to make say things that will get people closer to the Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what pleases him. And it will definitely benefit them, no doubt. And that is why the emphasis upon the majalis of Hussein alayhi salam has been found throughout our history. Because Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, being Safinatun Najat, being the Misbah al-Huda, the lantern of guidance. This is all related to the betterment of the spiritual journey and the struggle of the human being in life. You know, Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, majalis are revival of the hearts. They truly give us life, no doubt. The famous narration of the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam states, إِذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ لِعَبْدٍ الْخَيْرِ. If Allah wants khayr and goodness for a person, قَذَفَ فِي قَلْبِهِ حُبَّ الْحُسَيْنِ. Allah places in their hearts the love of Hussein. Allahu Akbar. Every story of Aba Abdullah, every narration, every struggle gets us in a better position in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if we utilize it, if we truly reflect on it. Those around him, his family members, those who understood who Hussein ibn Ali was, recognized that to adhere to Hussein ibn Ali is adherence to salvation, is adherence to God's path, to the rope that could get us towards Jannah, no doubt. And that's why when we hear and we read of stories of his family members yearning to meet Hussein ibn Ali, salamullahi alayhi, It is not only because he was their brother or husband or father, because Hussein is the ship of salvation. And Imam al-Rida says, a ship that's vaster and bigger and faster in the oceans, no doubt. When it comes to remembrance of his family members, no doubt one young daughter of Aba Abdullah asked for him more than perhaps anyone else. From the moment they left the plains of Karbala, for the weeks that they traveled, for the days that they were tortured in the dungeons of Yazid, this young daughter of Aba Abdullah would ask, where is Baba Hussein? Where is Aba Abdullah? Where is my father? Allow me to see him. Look at the ashq. Look at the intense love of a young 3-4-year-old daughter of Aba Abdullah. Because Allah says in the Quran, those who truly serve him, he will place their love in the hearts of mankind. But in the heart of Sakina, Ruqayya, it was more than the father she wanted. It was Sayyid Shababi Ahl al-Jannah. It was the son of Ali and Fatima. It was that compassionate, loving, fatherly figure for all, including her. Do we blame a 3-4-year-old girl to be so attached to her father? To be desperate just to see her father? To be yearning to be next to her father? And to be cuddled by him? To be kissed by him? To be picked up by him? Do we not do that for our own children? What crime has a 3 or 4-year-old daughter committed that she was deprived from this fatherly love, not just any father, but Aba Abdullah, the father of the compassionate and the merciful? That is why this young girl's passion and love for Hussein could not tolerate seeing the head of Aba Abdullah. No. People were not surprised when she left this world after seeing the severed head of Hussein on that bowl. When she picked up the head of Aba Abdullah and stroked it, when the tears from her blessed eyes fell on the cheeks of Hussein, when she kissed the blessed cheeks of Aba Abdullah, when she hugged the head on her little chest, what do we expect? She did no longer want this dunya. Her small soul could not tolerate being without Aba Abdullah. Perhaps up until that moment, she knew that Hussein was somewhere, that maybe she had hoped she would want to see her father. But the moment she saw the severed veins, the moment she saw the blood on his beard, she cried and said, "Father, who is it that's made me a yatim? Who is it that's made me an orphan? Father Aba Abdullah, who is it that severed your head from your body?" Wallah, the heart breaks when we hear of a story of such a suffering from a young girl. Because this man who had given so much for everyone had a special place in the hearts of everyone, but especially those who had his blood, who had his flesh. That for them, Hussein ibn Ali was greater than their soul. So their soul cannot remain in this world without Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, without being next to him. And that's why those around Sakina would cry and weep on this sight that breaks the heart of anyone, foe or friend, including Sayyida Zainab, who was entrusted with Sakina, who wanted to look after her, and indeed would do so as much as possible. But what can Zainab do? What can she do when this young lady would leave this world? Allahu Akbar, all she can do, as the poet said, she could speak to Aba Abdullah and then speak to Abul Fadl al-Abbas. She would say, Akhi ya Hussein, my brother Hussein, you gave me so much to look after. You asked me to look after your women and children, to look after Zain al-Abidin. Here is Zain al-Abidin and here are your women. But ya Aba Abdullah, I could not stop this daughter of yours joining you. Ya Hussein, her soul was too much attached to you. My soul is attached to you. My soul is attached to Abbas. But if it wasn't for Allah's will, I would like to join you. That's why when she came towards the grave of Aba Abdullah, that conversation with Hussein would remain forever. A heartfelt conversation that breaks the heart. When she says to Aba Abdullah al-Hussein, yes, I've come back to you in person, but part of you is not with me. Yes, I've come back to you and I have joined your head to your blessed body, but there is a part of you that is left in Sham, a part of you that for now, for years, we did not have a chance to visit. Peace and blessings be upon the young daughter of Aba Abdullah, As-Sayyida Sakina Ruqayya. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the visitation of the shrine of this young Shahida of Karbala and her intercession on the day of Qiyamah. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala accept our majalis, allow us to uphold all the principles of majalis, to learn, to get closer to him after each majlis, to base whether a majlis is successful or not on whether it is something that got us closer to the Almighty and the Ahlul Bayt alayhum assalam. Let us remember Marhum, Mohammed, Pyarali, Moledina, and all our Marhumin. والسورة المباركة الفاتحة.